Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the video lecture series of wireless cellular and 4G LTE, module number 1, lecture number 10. So today we'll be discussing more about in detail about the broadband wireless channel. Okay, in that one important topic here is nothing but fading. Okay, it's a very important topic here because we will not speak about the transmitter and the receiver. Okay, and we will only speak about the channel part. Okay, which is a completely a wireless channel. Okay, and what things are going to happen in the channel. Okay, so in my previous video lecture, okay, we have just seen about the broadband wireless some kind of losses like path loss and as well as nothing but we have the shadowing effect. Okay, then we have also discussed about the cellular concept and how we try to go for the sectoring mechanism, okay, which is an important part of the wireless communication system, okay, because instead of going for a large geographical area, if you try to do it by the method of sectoring, there is a possibility that we may achieve the very best efficiency, more reliable network, okay, and the communication will go very smoothly, okay. Now let us more focus on the broadband wireless channel, that is a fading part. Okay, now here in the broadband wireless channel, what actually this fading is nothing but due to different multipath losses, okay, there is a possibility that we may encounter with some kind of losses. Okay, so those type of losses are due to the fading effect. Okay, there is some kind of phenomena which is used in this wireless channel. Okay, so the in wireless channel, the fading is one type of a mechanism, or you can say a phenomena. Okay, just like the thing what we have seen in the previous, like path loss or a kind of a shadowing effect. Okay, and again when it comes to the large scale attenuation, okay, due to the very large distance, okay, or some kind of an obstacles, okay, the fading is caused by the reception of multiple versions of the same signal. That is what the small definition about the fading. Okay, it means that I'll just show you that figure here. Okay, just look at it, figure number 2.10. okay, if you look at this particular figure here, okay, so I have a building 1, okay, here I have 2 and this is my 3. Okay, so if you just look at this particular figure here, okay, you can able to just make out the things like this is the ground level. Okay, this is the ground level, and how to make out the things here is nothing but if this is my transmitter antenna, okay, that is nothing but my TX. Okay, and if I try to transmit my signal from this particular antenna to this receiving antenna, okay, now there is a possibility that there is no any kind of line of sight communication between my transmitter and the receiver. Okay, so once I send my signal, I don't know actually how this signal will travel here. Okay, so here is one path, you can see this is path number 1. Okay, this signal has been getting reflected from the ground level and just coming to this particular receiving tower. Okay, and there is another path from which travels to from 1 to 2 and then it comes back to 3, right? So because there is a window over here and it is just getting reflected from this particular window or the object and then it is hitting to the receiver. And there is another possibility that the fading of the signal is also possible by the local scattering. Local scattering is nothing but the nearby objects at the receiving antenna. Okay, it may get the signal may get scattered. Okay, and then they will just come back and reach to the receiving antenna. Okay, so how many total paths we have? Path number 1 and path number 2. So there are total 2 multipath along with one local scattering. Okay, so this causes the problem of fading here. So therefore, when it comes to the longer distances, okay, so the effect of fading can be caused by the reception of the multiple versions of the same signal. Okay, and the multiple received versions are caused by the reflections that are referred to as multipath. Okay, so whenever you just go for defining the multipath, you just define it as the multiple signals when it get reflected, okay, and when they are received at the receiver of the same signal, then it is defined as multipath. Okay, and the reflection may also be it very close at the same time. Okay, that is what here you can see in the local scattering. Okay, because of that local scattering, okay, there may be again due to different multipath occurrence can take place, and the number of multipath get increased, okay, between the transmitter and the receiver. Okay, so therefore, whenever some kind of reflection is arriving at this particular local area, or you can say that near area, and at the same time, okay, for example, there are three signals coming at the same time, okay, the combined effect of those reflection can be seen in this figure number 2.11. okay, you can just see here, okay, in figure number 2.11 there are two graphs, there are two waveforms you can see here, okay. So there is a, you can see there is one dark line here, this is signal number 1, there is a dotted line signal 2, and there is a dashed line, that is signal number 3. So at the same amount of time between 0 to 1 interval in terms of the nanosecond, you are able to receive the three different signal, okay, but may not be the same in their characteristics, okay, because they have encountered the multipath, they have encountered the local scattering, okay, they may have some destructive kind of interferences, or they may have this different signal frequencies, okay. So because of that, there is a possibility in small amount of phase change, okay, there may be possibility of the phase change, okay. You can just look out here in figure number 1, in the top figure, you can see one is starting at 0, the another is starting at minus 1, and you can see there is a change in the amplitude and as well as the change in the phase, okay. And even in the figure number 2, okay, you can also see that there is 0.1 nanosecond change in the phase, okay, which is correspond to around something around 3 centimeters, okay. So therefore, whenever there is a possibility of the reflection at the same time, and that is that too almost some nearly near time, okay, there is a possibility that there is a phase change difference between the arriving signals. Okay, you may say that all signals do not have the same phase. Okay, and the interference can be constructive or it can be destructive. Okay, there is a both possibility can happen in the wireless channel, that the signal either it can be constructive or it can be destructive. Okay, and because of this, there is a there may be a cause that a very large observed difference may be there in the amplitude of the received signal. Okay, that is what the figure says. You can see the dark line has a different amplitude, the dotted has different, and the dash has the different amplitude. Even in the figure 2 also there is a possibility. Okay, it is only because of either it can be constructive or it can be destructive. But when you try to go for the analysis for the very short duration of time, again, the difference in the amplitude may be changed. Okay, and the another important thing in the wireless communication, and when it comes to the wireless fading of wireless channel fading, okay, if your transmitter or either the receiver, okay, it is applicable for both, okay, either you can take it as transmitter or you can take it as a receiver. If any one of this is moving in the sense they are changing their place from one position to another position, either in a very short distance or either in a long distance, okay, dramatically, or you can say as a dynamically, again there is a possibility that you may encounter the change in the amplitude of the signal. It may not be the same, and whenever the mobile phone is moving from one position to another position, again there may be possibility that there is a path loss and there is a shadowing effect, okay, and sometimes it may not be the same, okay. So just to make out the things, not to have the change in the amplitude, not to have the losses, okay, we need to try to model the channel. We are not trying to model the transmitter or the receiver, we are trying to model the channel itself, okay. So how this can be done is either your transmitter or the receiver should be more relative to each other, okay, to the channel response, that is h of t will change. That is what we try to model in mathematically. Modeling of this particular transmitter or receiver has to be done, okay, with respect to the channel response, okay. So either this can be done in the two dimension, okay, and a delay dimension, that is tau, or it can be a time dimension t. And okay, you just look at this figure number 2.12. okay, you can just see in the figure number first figure and the second figure, okay. So in the first figure we have a response that is h0 h1 h2 till hv, okay, and but it is only with respect to tau and t, okay, it is respect to tau and t, okay. Tau corresponds to how long the channel impulse response lasts, that is called as a tau, okay. and the channel is time varying because it is varying with the time. So the channel impulse response, it is also the function of time. So that is why it is taken as h of t comma tau, and it can be quite different at t plus delta t. Okay, t plus delta t, that is what you can see here in figure number 2. It can be different for the small change in time. So there are two functions which are defined here whenever you go for whenever you try to formulate or whenever you go for a modeling of the particular signal. Okay, and how this can be done? This can be done either by making use of some statistical methods. Okay, there is a next concept in the wireless communication or the wireless channel, how we try to go for modeling of the mathematical modeling or the statistical modeling of the wireless channel. Okay, and the another important and the fundamental function which we use for the statistical describing the fading channel is nothing but two-dimensional autocorrelation function. Okay, we know what do you mean by the autocorrelation function. Okay, taking the same signal and flipping it out and trying the correlation between the same signal. Okay, so when try to do that particular autocorrelation function, and that too in the two-dimension, okay, that can be more simpler function. Okay, and sometimes you can go with the three-dimensional plot also. Okay, and how we try to define the autocorrelation function for the wireless fading of the channel is nothing but a of delta tau comma delta t. Okay, we are taking the small change with respect to tau and t. Okay, is equal to the e of h of t tau 1 comma t1 multiplied by the response of tau 2 comma t2. Okay, this is a formula which has been shown here. Okay, so that whenever you try to go for autocorrelation function, either it can be in the two dimension or it can be the three dimension. Okay, the only the thing is why we try to do this is just to have the channel response properly, either with respect to the transmitter and the receiver, such that the fading of the signal has to be minimized, or the fading of the signal has to be need to be properly characterized. Okay, I will just show you one table here. Okay, which gives you the whole summary of the fading parameters. Okay, but with the rule of thumb. Okay, now there are some quantities which has to be monitored when you go for the wireless communication with respect to the wireless channel. Okay, so the quantities which we try to measure or which we try to define, either in terms with respect to the frequency, or whether if it is large or small, and how this particular parameters or the quantities will have an impact on LTE. That is what the main factor here is. Okay, so just look at this particular delay spread. Okay, now the delay spread is defined by tau, which is one of the parameter which has been defined in the wireless communication. Okay, how much amount of delay is occurring, okay, when you transmit a signal from a transmitting antenna to a receiving antenna, which encounters the effect of path loss, shadowing, and nothing but the third is nothing but fading. Okay, now if the distance is too large, okay, if the distance is too large between the transmitter and the receiver, what will be the condition? That is nothing but if the tau delay spread is greater than t, then the frequency we make use of a frequency selective. Okay, if it is small, then it is in the reverse case, then it is a flat frequency, will be flat. Now, what will be the impact is the larger the delay spread relative to the symbol time, the more severe the ISI. That is what, if you have a very large distance, if your distance is too large, if your delay spread is too large, then what is happening is nothing but there will be more severity, there will be more possibility that the inter-symbol interferences will be more, because if your distance is too large, there will be more number of multipaths. There will be more number of same signal. There will be more number of the same copies of the receiving signal at the receiver. Then it becomes more. It will take more time for the receiver to make it analysis and to have the proper signal such that it can be utilized it properly. Okay, so this is the first parameter. Now the second parameter is nothing but the bandwidth, coherence bandwidth. And if it is defined as, if it is 1 by BC is less than T, then we make use of flat frequency response. Then if it is greater than T, then we make use of frequency selective response. Now, how it will affect the LTE design? Okay, it provides the proper guidelines to the subcarrier. Okay, because if I have a very large amount of bandwidth, okay, if I have a large amount of the spectrum, what I try to do is I try to just break down into different subcarriers. Right now, how you assign that subcarriers is nothing but the bandwidth of the subcarrier, that is BSC. It is almost equivalent to the carrier bandwidth divided by 10. So it is just like one the allocated bandwidth or the coherence bandwidth. Okay, if it is predefined, like for example 1 gigahertz, so it will be divided by 10. Okay, and hence the number of subcarriers which is required for the OFDM modulation is nothing but it is L greater than or equal to 10 times of the bandwidth divided by the coherence bandwidth. Okay, then Doppler spread, it is defined by FD is equal to FCV divided by C. So if it is greater than the carrier frequency, then it is fast fading. If it is less than the carrier frequency or the speed of light, if I take C as a speed of light, then it will be like slow fading. Okay, and how we try to design with the LT is nothing but, so FD is it should be divided by the subcarrier. It becomes completely non-negligible subcarrier. Orthogonality is compromised. Okay, then the coherence time, it is denoted by TC. If your TC is greater than T, then it is slow. It belongs to the slow fading. If it is larger than T, it belongs to the fast fading. Okay, and there are the possibility of impact here is nothing but if the TC is small. Okay, then frequent channel estimation and limits the OFDM symbol duration, but greater the time diversity. Then the next is the angular speed denoted by theta of RMS. Okay, then the lot of diversity possibilities are there if it is for the non-LOS channel. Okay, and if it is small, it becomes effectively LOS channel, but not much diversity. But here the impact will be like multiple antenna array design has to be done. And some beam forming versus the diversity will come into existence. Okay, then coherence distance denoted by DC. Okay, and again the almost everything is same as above. Like we have the effectively, it is effectively LOS channel, but not much diversity. But and this is non-LOS. Okay, and determines the antenna spacing. What should be the antenna spacing? Because if you are trying to make use of multiple antenna, if you have an array of antenna, but what should be the distance between the two antenna? What should be distance between the respective consecutive or adjacent antenna? Okay, you cannot place the two antenna completely nearby each other. There should be some gap, right? So it has to be determined well before when you try to design your LTE system. Okay, so apart from the whole parameters or the table of this table summary of the broadband parameters with respect to the rule of thumb, okay, there are two things has to be discussed. That is nothing but one is the delay spread and what about the bandwidth. Okay, are they important for the designing of the wireless channel, or whether any property of the wireless channel changes if my delay spread is less or if the delay spread is more when it is compared with the coherence bandwidth. Okay, so this is the one thing. The second thing need to be aware, we try to do the comparison is nothing but with respect to the Doppler spread and the coherence time. Okay, so these two parameters are more important. And there is another thing which here is nothing but the angular speed and the coherence distance. Okay, so these three things has to be discussed, that whenever you try to design any wireless channel. Okay, so the first thing here, what we more focus is nothing but delay spread and coherence bandwidth. Okay, so delay spread, again, it is one of the important property of the wireless channel because it specifies the duration of the channel response. Okay. And apart from that, the delay spread can be found by inspecting the tau value. Okay, but with respect by doing some kind of an autocorrelation function. Okay, but it is again completely referred to the multipath intensity. Okay, or you can simply say that it's a power delay profile. Okay, and it has been defined or given by the formula when it try to go for the impulse response, that is V, it will be equivalent to tau maximum, that is what is the delay spread maximum which has occurred at the receiving time with respect to the time duration, or simply you can take as a sampling time. Okay, because whenever the term frequency comes, there should be some kind of a criteria which we should use, that is nothing but the sampling time. Okay, so this is one formula which they try to use for the mathematical modeling. And again, they also try to check for the RMS values. Okay, whether the delay spread which has occurred is with respect to the width or with respect to the spread of the channel response. Okay, and the second thing, what they try to categorize by making use of the above table, that is the rule of thumb, which says that the tau maximum should be equivalent to 5 times the RMS values, okay, just to have the proper delay spread. And apart from that, here the another thing which they try to define with respect to channel coherence is nothing but your bandwidth or the coherence bandwidth is in the frequency dual of the channel delay spread. It means that it should be double or it should be twice, okay, with respect to the delay spread, because if your bandwidth is too small and the delay spread is too large, okay, it becomes very difficult for the analysis, because you need to define the lower frequency and you need to define the upper frequency, okay? That is what we define the bandwidth or the channel frequency response, okay? And it has to be correlated in such a way that there should not be any kind of what we say here actually is nothing but there should not be any delay spread, okay, such that the range, whatever we try to define it, the spread should belong into that particular range itself, okay? So this is one thing here. And the second thing here is nothing but the Doppler spread and the coherence time, okay? Now actually this whole thing belongs to the distribution part, okay? Because there are different types of distributions are there. One thing distribution where this wireless communication which uses is nothing but the power distribution or statistical power distribution of the channel over the time for a single transmitted just for an instant, that is Doppler power spectrum, okay? So everything is like they need to mathematically model it, how they try to define, okay, how what happens if your mobile phone or either of the transmitter or the receiver is trying to move from one position to another position. Is there any change in the power spectrum? Yes, there is a change in the power spectrum because of the motion, okay, because of the motion between the transmitter and the receiver, okay? And this Doppler power spectrum will be defined by making use of the Fourier transform. You can just look at this formula, okay? So by making use of Fourier transform, okay, they try to define the Doppler power spectrum, and they also try to define the power Doppler spread, okay? It is defined by FD is equal to FVC divided by C, and where this V is nothing but the maximum speed between the transmitter and the receiver. FC is the carrier frequency and C is the speed of light. If you know these particular values, okay, then you can definitely, you can find the what is the actual Doppler spread which has been occurred between the transmitter and the particular receiver. Because what is happening, happens in the Doppler frequency, Doppler effect is nothing but whatever the signal you transmit, okay, some part of the signals or the some part of the frequency will reflect back to the to the receiver, okay? And this topic of the Doppler effect, they are widely used in the radars, okay, radar communication, or you can take a sonar, so in the sonar, like in underwater, okay, because in the military also, okay, because whenever I transmit a signal, okay, if you just go back, I can try to calculate or I can try to make out the things very easily by making use of this Doppler effect, okay? It is just like the change in the frequency over the entire bandwidth, okay? But not necessary that the frequency whatever I receive may be the same, okay? It may change, okay? So this is the another thing which the focus will be more in the wireless communication, that is nothing but the Doppler. And how we try to correlate by making use of mathematical, that is coherence time and the Doppler spread, is it is given by the TC, that is coherence time, is equivalent to 1 divided by the FD. It is just like it means that my coherence time will be inversely proportional to the Doppler spread. It means that if I increase the Doppler spread frequency, then your coherence time will be completely coming down, okay? So if the transmitter and receiver are moving fast relative to each other, hence the Doppler will be large, okay? And the channel will change more quickly than if the transmitter and the receiver are stationary. Okay, that is what the difference here in Doppler spread and coherence time, okay? And here you can see there is one table. So if your carrier frequency is from 700 megahertz, the speed will be 2 kilometers per hour, okay? That is the speed. And the maximum Doppler frequency in terms of hertz is 1.3, but the coherence time is 775. That is what, if your Doppler spread is less, your coherence time will be obviously more, okay? Just putting into this particular formula, you can make out the things, okay? So this is how we try to make out the things. And the last part here is the angular speed and coherence distance, okay? So angular speed is nothing but finding the angle theta with respect to some that is what happens is nothing but if you are trying to make out the things with respect to antenna, then there will be some kind of some radiation pattern, and then how we try to go for the checking of the power also. Okay, so what happens in the wireless communication here or in the channel is nothing but if we try to make out the statistical distribution of the angle of our arriving energy, because two things we need to calculate. One is the power or either in terms of energy. Okay. So if the receiving signal has some kind of an energy or some kind of a power, okay, at what particular angle you are trying to receive the more energy? More energy is nothing but your signal will be more, have more information, because whenever you try to have this particular energy which is coming from many direction, because it has encountered multipath, right? So when you try to go for this many and finding the large theta value, okay, or either the small theta value, then your focus should be more on the energy. Okay, and what happens is a large angular spread generally occurs when there is a lot of scattering. Okay, now if in the other way, you can say that if the angular spread is small, it means that you may not encounter a more number of multipath, and there is no loss of energy, no reflections. Okay, so therefore, the dual of angular spread is the coherence distance. Okay, and how they have defined here is nothing but a coherence distance is approximately equal to 0.2 into lambda divided by theta RMS. Okay, so again, when you try to study in more detail about the fading, we have one type of a fading called as a relay fading, which assumes as a uniform angular spread occurs. Okay, so whenever there is a uniform angular spread has occurred between the transmitter and the receiver, or simply you say that in the wireless channel. Okay, so the relation how we try to show up here is the coherence spread is approximately equal to 9 times the lambda divided by 16 pi. Okay, so this is how the different types of angular speed can be calculated with respect to coherence distance. Okay, and when you try to go for multiple antenna, obviously there will be different parameters will be noted down, and they will be calculated based on the statistical values. Okay, so one thing please remember, whenever we try to model any model, either in terms of wireless or any other aspect, statistical parameters plays a very important role. Okay, either the signal will be completely dependent on the statistical parameter calculations, or it can be sometimes independent. Okay, and the another thing here is nothing but if the coherent distance, if they are very small, it means that the antenna array can be effectively employed to provide rich diversity. Okay, so this is how we try to make out the things by making use of some formulations. Okay, so with this, I will conclude my today's video lecture here. So in the next class, we will be trying to see how we try to model the fading of the signals. Okay. So with this, I will just conclude this today's video lecture. Thank you.